Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Lift up your right hand and say hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Praise hallelujah. Jesus.
Hallelujah.
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 Hallelujah. Thank you, Father.
Thank you, Father.
Praise you, Father.
Praise you, Father.
Thank you, Holy Spirit.
Thank you, Holy
Praise
Spirit.
Praise you, Holy Spirit.
Praise you, Holy Spirit.
Hallelujah.
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 Praise the Lord. Let's pray together. Hail Mary, full of grace. The Lord is with you. Blessed are you among women, and blessed is the fruit of your womb, Jesus. Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners, now and at the hour of our death. Amen. Praise the Lord. Please be seated. Dear brothers and sisters, when Jesus started his ministry, his preaching, and when John the Baptist also started his preaching, the first thing both of them preached was about repentance. Jesus said, "Kingdom of God is near to you. So repent." John the Baptist also preached about repentance. And this Lenten season, we are reflecting about repentance. And we are leading a life of repentance. Jesus spoke about kingdom of God. But later, we do not find that Jesus is talking much about a king or about his power in the kingdom. But instead, he is talking about a father, and he is talking about the characteristics of kingdom of God, our status in the kingdom of God as children of God. So you have to call God Father. He did not say we are the citizens of that kingdom, but he said we are children of God. So, the terms that Jesus used, they were about a relationship. And we have to think that way also about repentance. For example, what is repentance? To speak about repentance, Jesus gave us a beautiful parable that is, of course, the parable of the prodigal son. In that parable also, what we understand, the real repentance is about a relationship. When the son, he went away from father's house, a relationship was broken, at least for that son. And what is repentance? When he came back to father's house, and when he was ready to repair that, to mend that relationship, that became the real repentance. Jesus, he always gave importance for relationships. He was not just preaching the gospel. He was not just healing the people. He was not just performing the miracles. But the foundation of everything, foundation of his preaching, foundation of his healing, foundation of performing miracles, everything was a relationship. He wanted to make a relationship, or he wanted to call everyone into a relationship. That's, of course, relationship to Heavenly Father. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. So Jesus always appreciated the relationships also. For example, when Jesus entered the house of Zacchaeus, Jesus is not demanding anything from him. But instead, by the very presence of Jesus in his house, something is happening there. That's why Zacchaeus, he stood up and he said, "Lord, I am giving half of my wealth to the poor. And if I have defrauded anything of anyone, I am ready to give back fourfold. What is actually happening? He's repairing a broken relationship. Zacchaeus, he was not just a tax collector. It's written in the gospel, he was a chief tax collector. So people did not go to him because he was as a chief tax collector, he was an agent of Romans. So people, they did not love him because he earned for himself and also for Romans from these people. So his relationships were broken with that people. So at the same time, you know, when he was ready to give back everything that he defrauded, and also when he was ready to share his property, his wealth with the poor, he was mending that broken relationship. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Then Jesus said, today salvation has been come to this house. This family has been saved because he became ready to mend or repair the broken relationships. That's what we see from the life of Zacchaeus. You know, Jesus, he was visiting the houses and people. For example, when he heard that the mother-in-law of Peter, she was sick, Jesus visited that house and Jesus healed her. Jesus often visited the house of Lazarus, Mary and Martha. Praise the Lord. And he was spending time there. He had an intimate relationship with Lazarus. That's why he is shedding tears at the tomb of Lazarus. Also we read Jesus spent time in the house of Mary and Martha, and Mary was listening to Jesus. They had a good relationship. Jesus appreciated that relationship. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Dear brothers and sisters, I think during the time of this Lent, we have taken a lot of decision at the beginning of the Lent. That is to abstain from certain things. Mainly from some food. Abstain from meat. Abstain from fish. Abstain from certain bad habits. Of course, that is very good. But we have to think how much abstaining from this food or from certain things, certain pleasures, how much it could help us for our spiritual growth. After 40 days, after 50 days, again we will start eating everything. And sometimes to compensate what we are avoiding now, we will be eating other things. Then this abstinence for these days, how it could help us? In the Old Testament itself, the Lord is talking about this fasting, this abstinence, what he wants from the people, what he demands from the people is righteousness, justice, and love. So when we think in that, based on the words of the sacred scripture, what prophets demanded from the people, the real fasting, the real abstinence, it's all about repentance. It's all about repentance. And of course, repairing the broken relations or mending the broken relationships. So, these days what we have to think about is about our relationships. Our family relationships. Relationship to our neighbors. What I see is this. Often, you know, after all these retreat centers have started everywhere, there are a lot of conventions and preaching as we have here. The people has started even misunderstanding this spirituality. For example, every week I find on Friday after the retreat when all of them are going back, at least some of them will come and ask, Father, can I stay here? Because if I go back, I will again start doing all the evils which I had been doing all these days. So can I stay here? It's a safe place for me. Then what about your family members? What about your wife? What about your children? What about your occupation and other responsibilities? That God will see everything. God will see. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So this is not a real spirituality. Dear brothers and sisters, when we listen to the word of God, when we are filled with the Holy Spirit, if you really, we are really transformed, this transformation, this repentance, this Holy Spirit, this word of God, they actually give us a new grace, a new power, new strength to go back to our responsibilities, to take up responsibility and to lead a holy, sincere, responsible life. Praise the Lord. That is the real Christian life. That is the real spiritual life. Whether I am able to confront the realities of my life, whether I am ready to forgive others, whether I am ready to mend the broken relationships, that's very much important. Think about our family life. You know, what is more important? During the time of a retreat, there are a lot of healings, lot of deliverance, lot of God experience. What I see, the most difficult thing for a person who attends the retreat, what is more difficult for him is to forgive one person. Forgiving others is the most difficult thing. A special grace and deliverance is needed for that. Praise the Lord. Sometimes even to the parents, very difficult to forgive them. I have seen during the time of counseling, the parents, they share with the tears. In a family, there is only one son. They loved him very much. They lived for him, gave everything for his education and for his future life and everything. But once he got married, when a new person also came to the family, his wife, for a few days everything was okay. Then start all the problems. She cannot adjust with the situation. And what the solution they find, the easy solution is to find out another house, to shift from there. No, the only son, he leaves the parents, and at least for a rent, he is taking another house, and they start living. Parents, they think it's their life, and for their joy, for their peace, they are ready to suffer, tolerate everything. But they are always with tears, always with tears. Dear brothers and sisters, you know, in our society, now, even when we pray, when we listen to the word of God, when we are ready to keep a relationship with God through our prayer, but at the same time, I think we are going far from others, our brothers and sisters. When we travel in a train or in a flight, nowadays we do not want to talk to anyone. We always have the smartphone, mobile phone with us, with everyone. Earphone will be there. We are listening to music. We will be watching some films. We don't want to talk to others. Our relationships, now what happens? We do not want to know about others, what is happening to others. I remember for some years when I was abroad for my studies, that time during the vacation, we used to go for ministry in parishes. I was in Italy for some time. You know, what I have seen there, they do not have time because all the members of the family, they will be working. Husband and wife, both of them will be working. Morning, they have to go. Even if they come back, sometimes the husband will be working daytime. Wife has to go during night. They do not have much time together. And children, they will be studying or they will be far from them in another country. And they meet together often only on Sunday when they come for the Mass. Usually what we do here, just after Mass, we will go back to our home. But what they are doing, no, after the Mass, they will be there. They will be spending time together. Either they will go to a coffee shop and they will sit together and will talk for a long time. They will be sharing. And sometimes they have a system, you know, they will fix a day and a time offered for dinner. 5 or 6 families or some families for dinner, they will come together. And each family will bring something. And they will share the food and they will eat together. They will spend much time talking each other, asking about each other, much time they will spend together because they do not have other time to spend together. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So their life is, though their life is very busy life, at the same time, they find time to keep their relationships, keep their relationships. We just imagine in our family, usually, we spend much time for cooking. 2 hours, 3 hours we take for cooking to prepare everything. But for having food, how much time we spent? 10 minutes, 15 minutes. Within 15 minutes, everything will be over. We are concentrated only on having food. Am I right? So, parents, children, are we together to have food at least once in a day? At least for one meal? How much time we spend together to talk, to know each other, to hear the children, to hear the life partner. Often we do not have time for that. So it affects our family life, our relationship with our neighbors. Everywhere we do not have the time to develop the relationships. So we shall not think that we can have a spiritual life, a Christian life, when we pray too much, when we listen to the word of God, when we concentrate only on God. That's a kind of a spiritual selfishness. I and my God. For a Christian, we do not have such a life. I and my God. Hallelujah. If we call God above Father, we are admitting that others, they are my brothers and sisters. And we have to be responsible for their life also. We must be responsible for their life. As God asked Cain, where is your brother? We cannot ask God, am I the keeper of my brother? Yes, we are. We are the keepers of our brothers and sisters. We have responsibility towards them. Lift up your right hand and say hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Praise you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Praise you, Father. Hallelujah. You know, when we think about Jesus coming on earth, what we call incarnation, through incarnation itself, God was teaching about this relationship. Now onwards, God is not far away from us. Emmanuel, God with us. God is with us. It's a new relationship. Till that time, for the people, God was away, and whenever they call God, he visits them, he intervenes in their life. But now onwards, through the incarnation, God became a man and he started spending time with people. As we have reflected, Jesus was called a friend, a friend. And Jesus wanted to call others also friends. That's why Jesus said to his apostles, I do not call you servants. That relationship is not good. I call you friends. You are my friends. So that is an elevated relationship. Jesus wanted that. Even when Judas, when he came to Jesus to betray him, Jesus was calling him friend. Praise the Lord. That kind of a relationship Jesus always kept with others. Remember, why we are not able to have this relationship? Jesus, he met Philip and called Philip, "Follow me." Philip followed Jesus. And Philip met Nathanael, and Philip said, "I have met about whom it is written in the Moses law and in prophets, Jesus from Nazareth." Then Nathanael, he is asking, "Is it possible that any good come from Nazareth?" Philip said, "You come and see." Nathanael was coming to Jesus. And Jesus said about Nathanael, "Here comes a true Israelite in whom there is no deceit." Praise the Lord. You just reflect about Nathanael's comment about Jesus and Jesus' comment about Nathanael. Jesus started his preaching ministry in Galilean ministry. So Jesus was given the book of Isaiah. He opened it and he started reading. There it was written, "The Spirit of the Lord is upon me. I am sent to preach the good news to the poor, to proclaim release to the captives, and also to give sight to the blind, and proclaim an year of the favor of God." What we read there, at first all were amazed about Jesus. But after some time they started asking, "Is he not Joseph's son? Is he not Joseph's son, one among us?" Then Jesus said, You will ask me to do everything that I did in Capernaum. Here you have to do. And you will say to me, "Physician, you heal, you cure yourself." And Jesus said, "No prophet is accepted in his own hometown." And what is happening after that? The people, they are driving Jesus out. And they wanted to throw Jesus from the top of their hill where the town was there. They rejected Jesus. Why? Is he not Joseph's son? Why Jewish people, they could not recognize Messiah in Jesus? Because they had an expectation about the Savior, Messiah, Christ. They had an expectation. They had some calculations. Messiah would be like this. He would have these characteristics. He will be powerful. He will be a king. They knew who would be Messiah. That's why they were not able to recognize in Jesus the real Savior. The same prejudice Nathanael also had. That's why he is asking that question. Dear brothers and sisters, very often we are hesitant to have a relationship. We are hesitant to talk with someone just because of our prejudices and we are too much judgmental. When I see a person, you know, when someone is sitting near to me, already I have some prejudices about that person. When someone comes to me, I form some concepts about that person in my mind. Often it would not be true. I am often judgmental. So I close the door towards him. I close the chance to understand that person. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. When you think about your life also, you may find a lot of occasions where you misunderstood someone. The truth was not that about that person. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. You know, often we have some prejudices about others. I have misunderstood people many times. Last week, when I was preaching, two young men, they were often going out of the hall In between they will come, again they will go. And I was a little disturbed during the session. And after the session, I called them. I sent a volunteer to ask them. We called those youngsters. And they came. And I became angry. And I shouted at them, "What you were doing all this time?" And then they said, "Father, our mother, she is also attending a retreat. She's a mental patient. She was sitting back. In between, she was going out. We want to know where she was going. We must be always with her. That's why we were going out. We want to listen to your talk. That's why again we were coming inside." Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. So, you know, often we may say, "I heard what you were telling. I saw what you were doing." You know, that way often, "I know you." This is what we often repeat, "I know you." But actually we do not know anything about others, what they are thinking, what's their condition, how much they are suffering. But we easily misunderstand others. Dear brothers and sisters, during this season of Lent, I think we must become open to others. If there is a broken relationship, sometimes in our family, I'm not visiting my parents for a long time, or I do not call them, or one of my brothers, I do not have a relationship, there is a problem, or with our neighbors, the decision what we have to take during this season of Lent is to repair that relationship, to mend that broken relationship. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. And not only that, to spend more time for others. I want to relate to more people. Sometimes I have a character now. I do not talk to others. When I go for work, I do not talk to the one who is sitting near to me. Just ask his name, something about him, talk to him, smile at that person. This is the way we have to develop our relationships. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah.